Welcome back. Well, all eyes are on the United States this morning as the world waits to see how America will respond to the drone attack which killed three U.S. military personnel in Jordan.
It's tricky. Let's go to former Pentagon operative and White House advisor Tony Shaffer in Edmonton, North Carolina, to discuss. Tony, good to talk to you. Look, I had a look at this yesterday, but it's so layered and complex. They aren't going to bombard Iran with Tomahawk missiles. Shock and awe would last about a week, right? Iran's infrastructure is decentralized and underground. There's no appetite for a ground invasion of forever war, another one. Iran is backed by China and Russia militarily. They're not going to be an easy beat. The supply chains are all there. Wow. And American bases in Syria and Iraq become sitting ducks. What's a president to do with all of that?
First off, take out the supply chains. The Pentagon announced this past week, their spokesman said this, Carl, that they know the hand of Iran is behind all of this. Okay, cut off the hand. That's pretty easy. But to go from there, I think we have to look at what President Trump did 4 years ago to this month. When an American service, American civilian was killed, they immediately assassinated Soleimani, the director of the IRGC Quds Force, when he was in Iraq. So until there's some penalty for the Iranian attacks against our facilities, they're going to continue to do it. And let me say this. The reason that we're there, the American complex are there, these are artifacts from the buy with and through strategy used by my friend Joe Dunford, chairman of the Joint Chiefs, back under Trump to defeat ISIS. So there's been questions about why we're still there. I'm not saying this is the right time to pull them out, but obviously we have to start asking questions about what we are exactly doing in that region.
How do you take out a leader these days, though, without that causing some kind of global, you know, that's going to have an impact globally?
Yeah, so I don't believe for a minute the Iranians are seeking a larger conflict. But let's put it this way, Sarah. If you perceive your neighbor as being weak and you can go steal his lawn furniture and you can go take his tractor with no retribution, that's what's going to happen. So I think the moment you stand up and do, again, remember what, when President Trump did the attack against Soleimani, it shut the Iranians down for years. I think it's been this gradual reintroduction of weakness by the Biden administration, by the beginning with the flawed withdrawal from Afghanistan and all these other things which have led to the perception that the United States is not able to respond. That is the issue, the perception that we cannot respond. And at this point, nobody even knows what Joe Biden's going to do, because he said he made a decision, but he doesn't want to actually say what the decision is, and no action's been taken.
Could it
so
be
far.
Tony, that what they want to do, and if they want to take off the head of whatever organization, or they want to try and focus in on isolated parts of the country where these rebels are, that takes time. So there's no immediate solution, but the weight of it is starting to add up in the United States.
It is. And so to that point, it's a great point, Carl, but we spend, you know, we have the most expensive military on the planet. We do have extensive, what we call ISR, intelligence, surveillance, reconnaissance assets. Given the direction, and I know this because Joe Dunford was able to defeat ISIS in 10 months after he was told to go do it. Given the direction, the Pentagon could go do exactly what you outlined in pretty short order and be effective. The choice is to not do that and be effective. Again, John Kirby just said right before I came on, to your point, on a flight down to Florida with Joe Biden, that we're looking to degrade. Those are soft words. What does that even mean?
Yeah.
They don't really know what they're trying to achieve. And until there's clear policy established, we're not going to be able to do much to stop it.
All right, hold on. Let's see what they do.
Yeah.
Good to talk to you as always, Tony. You're a legend. Thank you.
Great. Thanks.
Developing this morning, U.S. President Joe Biden says he has made a decision about how to respond to a deadly drone attack in Jordan.
Yes, I don't think we need a wider war in the Middle East. That's not what I'm looking for.
U.S. correspondent Alison Piotrowski is live outside the White House for us this morning. Ali, good morning to you. We are now waiting to see what that reaction will be.
Yeah, the US president there was a little bit cryptic and very careful with his words there, wasn't he? Carl, as we wait to see how he responds, we know from the White House that any response will be multi-pronged, that it will come in stages and it will be over a sustained period of time, Carl. US President Joe Biden this morning speaking with the families of the three victims that were killed, the three Army reservists that were killed in Tower 22 in that Iranian-backed drone strike, which took place on Monday in the Jordanian desert. Meantime, overnight, Carl, we've had access to some astonishing images, some astonishing CCTV coming from the Jenin Hospital in the West Bank. This is an Israeli unit disguising themselves as staff members of a hospital where they shot dead three members of a Palestinian group. The Israelis, Carl, say that the group was about to carry out an attack on Israelis. Meantime, some positive news coming in from the Middle East. A framework for a potential hostage deal has been presented to the leader of Hamas. The leader of Hamas says he is studying it and he is open for discussions about it. In that framework, we know that there are two phases that have been presented to them. Phase one would be civilian hostages released over 6 weeks and three Palestinian prisoners released per civilian hostage. Phase two would be a longer pause where IDF hostages would be released, that is Israeli Defence Force hostages, and a higher number of Palestinian prisoners exchanged. But look, Hamas had already indicated that what they wanted was a complete withdrawal of troops. But Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu saying this morning that he's not interested in that, nor is he interested in releasing thousands of Palestinian prisoners. Carl?
That's a busy house behind you. Ali, thank you.